It is another edition of the Daily Grossi. Chris Holdeck and our Browns analyst Tony Grossi alongside us. The preseason in the rear view window, and now we turn our attention to the Dallas Cowboys. But before we can get there, Tony, we got to start talking about what the roster is going to look like big day Tuesday as the Browns have to get down to 53. And we started getting some puzzle pieces of that today. Browns head coach Kevin Stefanski letting us know that the offense specifically going to start getting some reinforcements back off of the injured list and off of PUP. Let's start there on the offensive side with the biggest names coming off: Jack Conklin and Jed Wills. Those two guys off the PUP list. Jack Conklin practicing tomorrow. Jed Wills not yet. What do you make of the situation now at left tackle?
Well, I would think with the three practices today, this week, Jack Conklin will be practicing at left tackle. The coach wouldn't admit that. We'll see for our own eyes tomorrow, but I think that's the intent because Jed Wills is not ready to go just yet. Obviously, they cleared him off of PUP, which means they do expect him, you know, within the next 4 weeks. I think it'd be closer to the next week. And that'll be a race between the two of those players to see which one plays left tackle at Dallas. It's either going to be Jack Conklin or Jed Wills.
So today you would have to assume right now that would be Jack Conklin. Right. If that were the case, Conklin at left tackle, DeJuan Jones at right tackle, how good do you feel about the matchup against the Cowboys defense and specifically Micah Parsons?
Well, I feel a lot better than a week ago when it could have been Jermaine Ifedi. What's surprising is that it appears that Conklin has passed Jedrick Wills in the race to be playing in the opener. And Conklin's surgery and recovery was much longer, much more major. And yet here we are a week before practice week against Dallas, and Will still isn't ready. So I think they feel comfortable that Conklin can do it short term. I'm not sure long term.
Sure.
If you would make the switch at left tackle, but certainly for one or two games, he's the best option left.
Let's say that is the starting five just for the sake of this conversation. Conklin left tackle, DeJuan Jones right tackle. Let's say Wills is out of the picture. Backup left tackle, is that still a Fetty then at that point?
No, James Hudson is a guy who is also returning to practice this week, the coach said. He had the ankle injury from the Minnesota game. I think all along they've been grooming Hudson as a backup left tackle, which would still be an improvement, I think, over Jermaine Ifedi. So I think that's the hope, is that they have Conklin and Hudson ready for the Dallas game, and they'll feel a lot better about that.
A name on the offensive side of the ball, to no surprise at all, not coming off the PUP list, Nick Chubb. That means he will miss at least the first four games. Are we still feeling around the bye week shortly thereafter as the tentative return? I know there were some rumblings with Browns fans over the last couple of weeks that, oh, maybe he could come back early. But no, we got the news today officially out for at least first four.
It was never the intent of the team to have him available for the first month of the season. They wouldn't say that. They don't want to discourage Chubb. But Chubb knows where this thing stands also. So I think the medical team, Chubb, and the Browns, we're all gearing for the middle of the year. You know, they have that bye week after week 9, I believe. Or is it week 8? I always confuse it. But it's pretty much in the middle of the season. And, you know, they'll revisit as that approaches when he returns. He still has to practice before he gets in the game. So there could be a 2-week practice period. So before he's even suitable to play in a game. So I still think, Chris, it will be after the bye week. Maybe it'll be a surprise, you know, a week or two earlier. Let's hope.
Yeah. Another running back we're waiting to see and come back from injury, Nyheim Hines as well. How do you feel about the running back depth as we enter the season?
Well, Pierre Strong is also practicing this week. You know, he suffered the rib contusion at practice last week, hitting a a heavy bag in a position drill. But he'll be back this week. So, again, we got till September 8th to get on the field again. I think they feel good. Ford, strong. And maybe even by then, Nyheim Hines will be available. The coach said he has not been activated from NFI. Remember the non-football injury. It goes back to the jet ski of last summer. But he could be activated or cleared to practice before the end of the week.
On the defensive side of the ball, a few more names that Stefanski said will be coming back. De'Anthony Bell, Dalvin Tomlinson, Greg Newsome, Jordan Hicks, Tony Fields. So any name on that list that specifically jumped out to you almost as, oh, my God, thank goodness he is coming back from injury?
Well, yeah, I think they're really happy to have Tomlinson and Newsome cleared to practice. Both of them had surgeries. Remember the first day we arrived in Greenbrier, it was a news bomb that they were both going to have scope surgeries. And they said at the time they think they could be back for the start of the season, and they were right on because they're in position to be ready for the season. Tomlinson, both of them are extremely important to the defense. Tomlinson starting right tackle, and Newsome, this, starting nickelback. So, that'll bolster the defense just in time for Dallas, for sure.
Denzel Ward. Stefanski really didn't say any way, one way or another. He's progressing, basically. Any concern that he will not be available again, suffered the concussion and the joint practices? Any concern he's not going to be ready for Dallas?
Well, it's not a good sign that he's still not cleared from protocol. I mean, this is an injury that occurred in practice before the Minnesota week. And it was a result of a collision with Elijah Moore. And on the way down, Ward's back of his head hit the ground. And here we are 2 weeks later. He's still in protocol. You've got to believe that the accumulation of injuries to his head is what's taken this long. Because I remember seeing the play and seeing Denzel Ward get up gingerly, but he wasn't like ushered into the facility. He stayed on the field on the sidelines and watched the rest of practice. And apparently the side effects of that accident is still happening. So, yeah, I think you got to be concerned at this point. I certainly thought he'd be back by now.
Tone, just to focus on Ward for a second here. I know no one's really talking about it, and I'm not saying it's going to happen. Is there a chance that he just reflects on his NFL career and is considering stepping away? Now, again, I don't want to make it sound like he has or you're reporting anything, but Tony, I think it's worth the conversation, even though some Browns fans might get upset. Fifth known concussion, and I believe this is year six. Seven. So, it's taking longer and longer.
Before this recent concussion, this goes back to the Greenbrier. I asked Denzel Ward about wearing the guardian caps. Last year, cornerbacks did not have to wear them. This year, they were included among the positions that had to wear them. I said, what do you think about it? He didn't like wearing them. And I said, well, what about, given your history of concussions, would you wear them in a game? Because players now are allowed to take this guardian cap in the game as an extra precaution about concussions. And he said, no, I don't see that happening. He said, I'm not concerned about the injuries I've had, the concussions. I've done a lot of research. He's consulted with the medical team on the Brown staff, and they feel unconcerned. That was before this fifth concussion. Yeah. So I don't know what he's thinking now. He was pretty strong in stating what he did prior to this. So and the coach and the team seems they're not panicking over this. They're going to treat this thing and let it play out protocol wise. So my answer is if they're not overly concerned, I don't know if I should be. So there's a lot of experts weighing in on this, and so far they don't appear to be concerned.
Overall, it's that balance all preseason we were talking about. Do you play Watson? Do you play the starters? Ultimately, none of the starters really got any reps. But on the flip side, if you go into it saying we need to be as healthy as we can be going against Dallas, you know, Ward, one of the exceptions, and a few others, mission accomplished, right? I mean, for the most part.
You're right. I mean, there's more than one way to do it, to get ready for the season. Right. And coaches, you struggle at times. Which way do I choose, A, B, or C? Well, Stefanski usually doesn't second-guess his decisions. And they, meaning the collaborative team that, you know, runs this organization, decided this was the best way to do it. And, it's frustrating to fans and media who cover every aspect of this team and want to see something on the field. But let's let it play out. We will see September 8th if this was the right plan. Even though those guys are now healthy, we'll see how they play. Because if they come out and lay an egg, I think it's easy to second guess it and say, you know, next year you better change your plan because this one didn't work. For the most part, since Stefanski's four seasons, I think if you take his record in the first four games, not necessarily the opener, but the first four games of your season, it's a pretty good record. So I got to trust in him. And I think they know what they're doing. It's just a matter to see if their method is rewarded.
All right. Two other things roster-wise real quick. Stefanski did not comment today when speaking with the media. Mike Hall, we expect him to be on the commissioner's exempt list. Do we have any more understanding there?
I wouldn't jump to that conclusion. The exempt list is a rarely used, very punitive measure by the commissioner. Now, he could face a suspension in the future. Let's let this play out. He has a court appearance on September 10th, 2 days after the opener. The NFL, I don't see doing anything before that, which means he'll be active. And already there was a report of the accused victim of his misdemeanor offense recanting some of her report to the police. So I think they're playing it out the right way. Just let it play out. I think there is a suspension in his future. Exempt is a little too punitive for it.
Fair enough. What do we expect to happen at QB3? And do we expect only three quarterbacks on the roster?
Well, to answer that one, I think there's a chance they could put the fourth one on the practice squad. I do think they'll keep three. I think the third will be Dorian Thompson-Robinson. I think there will be talk around the league. The Browns trying to trade Tyler Huntley. I don't know if there'll be any takers. Who knows? In 2 weeks, a quarterback may step in a hole on the field and there's a need for him. I think ideally they would trade Huntley. A second ideal would be put him on their practice squad. There's a lot of options there, and there's about 28 hours to go before they have to make their call. And even if I want everyone to remember, Tuesday at 4 p.m. are all the roster moves announced. That is not the Browns' final roster or anybody's final roster around the league. It will change in 48 hours. So guys that are cut may be brought back. Guys that are kept may be cut.
Tony, so you said at 4 o'clock tomorrow, we'll know at least the initial 53. Well, yeah, we typically ask it every year, but, you know, I don't expect any surprise cuts. It feels like we're pretty set all across the board. You know, in years past, it's all, what about tight end? You know, it feels like we're pretty good. Are there any things, though, Browns fans should be keeping their eyes open for by that 4 p.m. deadline tomorrow?
You know, I would think there could be surprise trades. And you look at the positions of surplus on the Browns, defensive tackle still, even though they traded one Chris Williams over the weekend, defensive tackle, cornerback, there's surplus. There's wide receiver surplus. Teams that are absolutely desperate to fill out their roster with a fifth receiver might call the Browns. But as far as, I don't know, headline grabbing trades, I would be shocked if there's something like that. And I don't see a headline grabbing roster cut either.
Okay, Tone, that just about does it. I mean, now that we've made it through the preseason, walk us through, last thing here, walk us through the schedule for the players on the field this week before the mandatory mini vacation before week one.
All right, so first let's start with the cut. It has to be announced by 4 p.m. tomorrow. It's, the Browns have a practice scheduled at, I think, 11:30 tomorrow. So teams, sometimes they conduct their practice and then make their cuts. Sometimes there's a slew of cuts announced in the morning. So that's possible tomorrow. Then they have a practice. Then the cut's at 4 and the roster moves. They also practicing Wednesday and Thursday afternoon. Then players get the weekend off starting on Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday. Labor Day weekend. It's in the CBA. So yeah. Coach is trying to get these players that just came cleared to practice. They got to get a lot of work over the next 3 days, right, and then start the following week facing Dallas.
All right, Tone, it's going to be a busy couple of days here with roster moves. We're going to be locked in all over it. Appreciate the time as always. We look forward to the 53 and then the Cowboys next week.
All right, Chris, we'll talk to you then.